Welcome to Conversation. Our guest today, for the first of a two-part chat, is my old friend David Kaufman, author of the best-selling biography, Doris Day, The Untold Story of the Girl Next Door. Conversations is Lehman College's series of discussions with and about major theater and musical figures of our time. Welcome to Conversations, David.
Oh, Bill, thanks for having me.
We're completely upstaged by Doris's Day scream. How can we follow that? That, of course, was the climax of The Man Who Knew Too Much, Alfred Hitchcock's masterpiece, and which Doris Day shot in 1956 with James Stewart. You have done a biography of a highly complex figure that everyone thought was the girl next door, the all-American girl next door. What ever possessed you to do this biography?
My primary motivation really was my feeling for a long time now that she has been terribly underestimated as both an actress and a singer. In fact, it's interesting to begin with The Man Who Knew Too Much because I think it's one of her very best performances. And it's, even though that film introduces what became her biggest song internationally, Que Sera Sera, it's not a musical film. She made 39 pictures in 20 years, ending in 1968. And her last handful of films are really not very good. They're pretty schlocky films, but she herself continues to be good in them. However, I think it's really because of that that she kind of, her film career fizzles. She's just terribly underappreciated, I think. Also for singing, because she made a lot of novelty numbers. Mitch Miller, the first person I interviewed for this book 8 years ago, he was her record producer, Columbia Records, for 10 years, during which she was the number one female vocalist in the country. And in fact, I'm sorry to be so long-winded, but very few people realize this, but Doris Day is the number one female box office star of all time, the only one to be number one 4 years in a row, and she was in the top 10 for a full decade.
And you make a point of it telling us that Doris Day represented to millions of people abroad the American image.
She definitely, during the 50s and 60s, she represented us to the rest of the world. And I think it has a lot to do with that image. I think that we were viewed as basically a very happy place, a happy nation, and she was viewed that way too. But beneath the surface, both in the country and for Doris Day, there's a whole lot of other things going on.
Now you've written, this is a hefty book, everybody. You get your money's worth with Doris Day, The Untold Story. The Untold Story of the Girl Next Door. This is the complete biography of Doris Day.
I'm pleased to say that beginning with Publishers Weekly, and many of the reviews have emphasized that this is the definitive biography. I fortunately got to interview over 150 people, including five different people who lived with her at different times, her fourth and last husband, a number of relatives, many people who worked with her. And so I got
the story.
But not
Doris Day.
Not Doris Day. I knew before I even started this book that even if I got to speak to Doris Day, I would never get to talk to her about the past. Because I knew that once she put the past behind her, which really neatly happens when she moves to Carmel, it kind of became her fortress.
From L.A. to Carmel.
From L.A. to Carmel in 1980. So we're really talking 28 years ago. The only thing she's been willing to talk about during that period are her pet causes, her pet foundation. She
meaning cats and dogs.
Yes.
Dogs
yes.
and cats, really. In
yes.
order. David, a little bit about you. We've known each other for 25 years?
Since 1986, so 22 years.
You were just, you used to work for this publisher.
I was working, the year before I met you, I left St. Martin's Press. I was at St. Martin's
right.
Press for 10 years.
And many years, a very one of the best reviewers, I must say.
Thank you. Theater reviewer.
Theater reviewer. And you've always been passionate about the arts. We've had many a discussion and a fight, God knows. This is your second book.
Yes.
The first book is your biography of Charles Ludlam. What is that called?
Ridiculous, The Theatrical Life and Times of Charles Ludlam, who wrote 29 plays in 20 years. While he ran his own theater company and starred in each of the plays and directed them.
How long has this book been out so far?
It's amazing to me because it's actually now 5 months, but it's in its third printing, and it looks like it's about to go in its fourth. I'm about to go on a book tour of Ohio, and it continues to do extremely well.
I never would have thought that there'd be such interest in Doris Day. I wouldn't have figured there wouldn't be, but why?
Well, I can only speculate, but I think one of the things, I don't mean to sound immodest, but I think a lot of people didn't even know that she was still alive until my book came out. And before my book came out on June 10th, there was a 17-page excerpt in Vanity Fair, and that really galvanized a lot of attention onto my book. Talking before about how Doris put the past behind her, I know from people who work with her now that she is never going to read my book. And that does disappoint me, because there are things in this book that she doesn't know about her own story, things that were happening behind the scenes. She was incredibly busy, not only making 39 pictures in 20 years, but recording over 600 songs during the period, giving thousands of interviews. She is one of the major American icons. And I think that that's one of the reasons there's this new interest in her, because people tended to really just put it in the past.
Right.
But I also think that this book came out coincidentally at a time when people want to go back to the past, because our present is not a very happy place to be.
I know, I couldn't wait to watch her movies again. Speaking of which, let's go back to her first movie, Romance on the High Seas. What year is that?
She made it in 1947, but it's released in 1948. So this is the 60th anniversary of her first picture.
Let's watch a clip from that one.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Georgia Garrett.
Echoes of Ella Fitzgerald and Billie Holiday in her voice, and also she was of that golden era of big band singers, Frank Sinatra.
Exactly. She was a big band singer for almost a decade before she made her first picture, and she became really big with her first hit, which was Sentimental Journey, which comes out, I guess it's very early in 1945, and it was a huge hit. It's not only a great song, but it was especially a huge hit because of what the song is about, with the soldiers who wanted to come back home, and with their wives, and with their wives who wanted them back home. And then the song that you just played for the audience, It's Magic, in her first picture, becomes her second enormous hit. And her third biggest hit is Secret Love from Calamity Jane, which many people consider to be among her best films. And then, of course, her fourth and biggest is Que Sera Sera, which she also made the theme song for her TV series. But to talk a little bit about her first picture, Romance in the High Seas, she had a screen test with Michael Curtiz, who had his own production company at Warner Brothers. It was Michael Curtiz who put Doris under contract. Her contract is not with Warner Brothers. Even though her first 17 pictures are made there, it's with Michael Curtiz Productions. Michael Curtiz was an incredible director. His biggest films were Casablanca, Mildred Pierce, The Adventures of Robin Hood.
Wow.
And he did Doris Day's first four pictures. His range was incredible.
But he was also a bit of a shyster in that the contract he signed with Doris was a slave labor contract. Oh. It was just, she never saw much of her, she should have even been richer.
In fact, the contract, this was the most amazing thing to discover. One of the great things that her agent, Al Levy, who had been Frank Sinatra's agent before, got for her in that contract with Michael Curtiz Productions was that her name would always be as big as anybody else's name in the credits and in the advertising. So in other words, it's kind of establishing her as a star from the get-go. Never a supporting player, but a star. On the other hand, the contract also stipulated that any fees she got for any live performances, which she continued to do quite a bit of, Michael Curtiz Productions got 50% of those fees. One of my prized possessions is a check that Doris Day wrote to Michael Curtiz Productions for a $1,200 fee from Bob Hope, who she performed with for 3 months.
That's very unfair. That's she had very poor advice. Now, this habit of hers of signing lousy contracts went on when she met her first husband, Marty Melcher.
Well, that's her third husband.
Third,
but most significant husband.
Yes, he, 17 years.
Her first, and this is one of the reasons she had to put the past behind her. She was married four times, and every marriage was very unhappy for her. Her first husband was physically abusive. She had one child, Terry, who was the son of her first husband when she was 18 years old, and he did not want her to have the baby. He even threatened to kill her and the baby by pointing a gun to her stomach when she was pregnant. And her second husband, George Weidler, who many viewers would know because his younger sister, actually his older sister, plays Katharine Hepburn's younger sister in the Philadelphia Story, and she plays, Virginia Weidler was her name, she plays Norma Shearer's daughter in The Women. George Weidler was Doris's second husband. Like her first, Al Jordan, he was a musician in the band that she was singing for at the time. And that marriage was very short-lived because he recognized that she was about to become a star and he did not want to be Mr. Doris Day, so to speak. And Doris's third husband, who you just mentioned, Marty Melcher, he at the time was married to Patty Andrews.
Of the Andrews sisters.
Of the Andrews sisters, and he was her manager. He was Patty, the Andrews sisters' manager. His partner, Al Levy, was Doris's agent. And as soon as he saw that Doris was about to become an enormous movie star, he had Al Levy transferred to the New York office. He moved in on Doris, he took her over, and then he marries her. But it was a miserable marriage. He really was her manager more than her husband.
This marriage went on for 17 years. She started out as Doris Kappelhoff in Cincinnati, is that right?
Yes.
She ended up as Doris Day. She never intended to be a singer. At first she was a dancer, and then she had an accident.
As an adolescent, she won a dance contest and was about to move to Hollywood with her mother when she was 13 years old, when she was in a car, train hitting a car, and it broke her leg. And just as the leg was about to heal, 8 or 9 months later, she fell on it and re-broke it. So that's why she turned to singing, because she started singing along on the radio with Ella Fitzgerald, who she loved. So the Ella Fitzgerald
influence.
Yes.
And she ended up in Hollywood, nonetheless. She ended up as a singer and then later as an actress. She became known as the girl next door in a movie By the Light of the Silvery Moon. We're not going to show any of that, but she departed from that image rather quickly. By 1952, she did an extraordinary movie called Love Me or Leave Me, the Ruth Etting story.
Love Me or Leave Me is 1955.
55, as late as that.
Yeah. And that's after she left Warner Brothers. Her first 17 pictures are at Warner Brothers. But that was done for MGM. It's one of the first that she did as an independent.
So she was willing to depart from whatever images that these icons she set up. She was willing to experiment and break the mold.
Well, she wanted to. I think she wanted to, and her husband also specifically with that film, Love Me or Leave Me, set out for the world to see that his wife was actually a very sexy woman. And she plays a real sexy person, Ruth Etting, who, by the way, was a number one singer in America in the 1920s and into the early 30s. And also married her manager.
Right.
So it's a very similar story. Doris recognized the similarities and very much identified with her. I also happen to think, as many other people do, that is Doris Day's best performance in her best picture.
We're going to see two clips from that of that movie. We're going to see 10 Cents a Dance, followed the song 10 Cents a Dance, followed by a scene of acting, extraordinary acting by Doris. So let her roll.
A dance, that's what they pay me. Gosh, how they weigh me down. 10 cents a dance, dandies and rough guys, tough guys who tear my gown. 7 to midnight, I hear drums, loudly the saxophone blows, trumpets are tearing my eardrums, customers crush my.
Everybody come to California to lay around in the sun, and she got to sit in the house.
Hello, Ruth.
Oh, hello, Barney. Can I get you a drink?
Thanks.
Everything go all right?
Fine.
Good.
Of course, Mr. Hunter was disappointed that you weren't with us. Say, you have a lot of meetings tomorrow. There's wardrobe and makeup and publicity and, well, Marty has the list.
Yeah. You start with the music director. And will you hear who that is? Johnny Alderman, a piano player from Chicago. He always gave me a swift pain, that guy. Why should he be on a picture? Piano player like that. We would have somebody good, a name.
Well, he's making a name for himself.
Well, let him make it on his own time. How do you feel about it, Ruth?
I don't care one way or the other. Whatever you say.
Well, we leave it late for the time being anyway.
Hunter's a nice fella, don't you think?
Yeah, a four-flusher, just like the rest of them. You know how long it took me to get his number? Just about 1 minute. And I let him know it, too. Did you see the expression on his face when I told him his last three pictures were stinkeroos? I really let him have it, didn't I, Barney? That's the only way with those phonies. You gotta let them know who you are.
Who are you, Marty?
What do you mean?
What have you accomplished? Can you produce a picture? Have you done one successful thing on your own? Just who do you think you are?
Who do you think you are? What a cold that's so unlike the image we have of Doris Day. And of course, she was playing with that great actor, James Cagney. And
she made a number of pictures, which I think would surprise a lot of people. But the notion of her image, even though Marty Melcher, another manager named Marty, set out with this picture to show the world another side to Doris Day, his wife, he quickly reverts to trying to get back to the girl next door image, which he very much cultivated during the beginning of her career and for the duration of her career. When I mentioned earlier about the last few films she made, how schlocky they were, Mike Nichols approached Doris Day to play Mrs. Robinson in The Graduate, one of the all-time great American films. Mm-hmm. And Marty would not let her do it because it's so contrary to the girl next door image. It's about an older predator woman preying on a young man. And if only Doris had made that, I think that her career as a film actress, and this is the last, it's released the last year of her last films, 1960. Well, it's actually released the year before, 67. But I think the world would have recognized her talents much more.
Marty Melcher did more than thwart her career. He may have connived with, it is possible that he connived with their lawyer to salt away money.
There are many different feelings. Doris herself claims in her memoir, which was published in 1975, written with A.E. Hotchner, that at the time of Melcher's death in 1968, when he was, I believe, only 53, and it was a shock to her, but equally shocking was the discovery that not only did she not have her $23 million fortune, but she owed $400,000 in back taxes. And it came out within a year that her lawyer, her husband's partner and lawyer, Jerome Rosenthal, mm-hmm. had either lost or stolen all of that money. And in her memoir, Doris claims she didn't know if Marty knew about this or not at the time of his death. What I uncovered is that he did know about it. I think he learned about it only a few months before his death, and I think it might have even hastened his death.
Been responsible for the loss of $23 million might have come to a shock to anyone.
There are, to this day, some people believe that Marty had stashed a lot of the money away in Swiss bank accounts, but I don't think that that's true at all.
Doris seemed to be living in her own dream world for a lot of her career. How is that possible?
Well, from the time that she was a little girl, I mean, one of the most pivotal events in her life occurred when she was around 9 years old. Her parents had a party in Cincinnati. Doris was tired. She put herself to bed, and she wasn't really asleep, but she was pretending to be asleep when her father came tiptoeing through her bedroom into the next bedroom with her mother's best friend, and Doris heard them making love and had to pretend to be asleep when they were finished and came back through the bedroom. Doris kept this secret to herself for a few years, and I think keeping that secret to herself from her mother, it shaped her life. I think it prevented her from ever being able to confront anybody with her true feelings, which is really very, very sad. She has claimed at numerous times throughout her life that the only thing she ever wanted was to be happily married and to have a happy family life. And it's the one thing she never had. So here, this person who had some of the greatest success of anybody in the world and worked so hard, it's really a very sad story. But she also, many people I talked to had anecdotes about how she could just tune out in the middle of a conversation, just become vacant. And I think it has everything to do with that early childhood experience.
The Melchers made up a myth about their home life. They had the perfect marriage and the perfect couple. And did they do this to convince themselves or the world or both?
Certainly not themselves. It's really the world. I think the first few years of their marriage, it might have been relatively happy, but it was extraordinary for me to discover that 5 years into their relationship, Melcher issued a contract between the manager and the artist, the manager being Martin Melcher and the artist being Doris Day. So, I mean, it's very common in Hollywood for there to be prenuptial agreements, but this may be the first time that there was a postnuptial agreement, 5 years, in fact. But it's because I'm pretty sure he realized that the marriage was not making Doris happy. In fact, she did try several years after that to divorce Melcher. She kicked him out of the house in 1962.
They're indicating that we have to bring this first part to a close. We have so much more to talk about. I'm glad there's a second part.
I am too.
As we go out, we're going to be playing a little bit of an interview with Johnny Carson. The circumstances are interesting. Doris had just had breast augmentation surgery.
As well as a facelift.
And from the body language, we will see how Johnny handled the situation. So.
And how Doris did, too.
I wanted to thank you, David, and our home and studio audience for joining us today. And we hope to see you again soon for part two of my conversation with David Kaufman. Thank you, David.
Get out and do what you want to do and forget it. Right?
Doctors are going to kill you when they hear that. They said, don't even swing a racket. Don't try to go out on the tennis court for 3 months because you could redo this thing.
Really?
Yeah.
I would enjoy myself.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you?
Oh, I would indeed, but maybe you're different than him.
I certainly hope so.
Well, are the vertebrae in a man's neck and women any different?
I wouldn't think so. I think that we're about the same around there.
But below the neck, the changes start rapidly.
Yeah.
From that. Yeah, thank you for being here.